We're now turning our focus to entrepreneurial development, which is also affected by new or continuing policies. Joining me now is a specialist consultant with expertise in entrepreneurship and business development. She's also the director of entrepreneurship for the Tony Entrepreneurship Program. Parminder, thank you so much for joining me on the program.
Good morning. Pleasure. Thank you very much for having me.
So, let's talk a little bit about the elections. Your observations, of course, this process, this election process, presidential elections.
I think it's fascinating to be in Nigeria, particularly during the election period, because that's a time when you really begin to hear what really matters to the common person, in terms of the economy, you know, what are their pain points, Is it around the infrastructure, around water, the price of food, just transportation, etc., etc. So for me, as an outsider, it's absolutely brilliant to just watch the two parties debate and discuss, And I'm looking forward to being here on Saturday, waking up on Sunday morning and Monday, and hearing the results, I've talked to my colleagues in the office and to my friends, in the time that I've been in Lagos, about what it is that they're looking for, what change are they looking for. Inevitably, we all look for change, and it's fantastic that in Nigeria we have a democracy, and people are actually openly debating and discussing issues. Similarly in the UK right now, we're preparing for an election, My other country of origin is India, and we've had a massive election there, and a real change in direction in the way that country is going. So I'm absolutely looking forward to it.
Another thing I'm very sure that since you're an expert in business development and entrepreneurship, we'll be looking at policies and initiatives that will encourage entrepreneurs to grow in Africa. Now, with our situation, you're talking about the fact that we either might have a continuity or might have new policies. But looking at it as a whole, do you think that there are policies and initiatives that actually encourage entrepreneurs to grow?
Absolutely. In terms of Nigeria, entrepreneurship is in the Nigerian DNA. The Nigerian economy is thriving, yes, because of government intervention and support. They're doing the job for which they are elected. But without the private sector and without the entrepreneur, the economy would not be growing at the pace at which it is growing. So the role and the contribution of the medium entrepreneurs, from the startup right up, through the value chain, is vital. Your own finance minister will tell you that their contribution, that their role to really keeping the wheels of any economy going. Nowhere in the world can you ignore the power and the contribution, the intelligence of the entrepreneur, wherever you are. No wonder now that there is a global movement, literally called Global Entrepreneurship Movement. And Nigeria, because of the size of its economy, the size of its population, is a highly educated population, right? But also, it's a very young population. And where do you find most of your entrepreneurs? They are in that 20 to 30 age bracket, or the demographic. And in launching our own program, it's one initiative amongst many around supporting entrepreneurship. But what for me has been so amazing is that it's one idea, an idea of the Tony Elumelu Entrepreneurship Program, TEF, which we unleashed onto the world on the 1st of December. We launched our portal on the 1st of January. We got 20,000 applications.
Okay,
20,000, can I just finish? From Pan-Africa, Francophone, Anglophone, and Lusophone. Now, give me some amazing ideas that are really connected Pan-Africa in one go.
Well, Parminder, this is just one in many. It seems as if it's been more public sector driven than private sector driven. So looking at encouraging entrepreneurship, in Africa, Nigeria now, should it be more public sector led or private sector led?
Well, I think what's exciting about TEF is that it's private sector led. And not is it only private sector led, it's led by an African So the program is led by an African, it's made in Africa, and it's made and it's for Africans. I think that's the fundamental uniqueness about TEF, that it is homegrown, right? It's not an offshoot of some American program or some European program, and that is fundamentally important. The second is that he has made a phenomenal commitment. You know, he is using, he is wealthy, but he is using, he recognizes with wealth comes responsibility. And he is using his responsibility and his wealth to support, through his philanthropic arm, the Tony Irwin Foundation, to support and invest in African entrepreneurs. I can't think of a better way of using your wealth than to empower the next generation of African entrepreneurs. Yeah?
Okay, so that's just
so it's a long-term commitment. It's long-term and it's sustainable.
But that's just one, you know, that's just one individual. Looking at it as a whole, should the private sector lead, you know, the growth and development of entrepreneurs, or should it concentrate mostly with the public sector?
No, absolutely not. They have an absolute role to play. And Mr. Tony Irwin is leading by example. We can sit here and say the private sector should do this and they should that and the public sector should do this. But you, at some point you have to stop talking and start doing. And for me, that is exactly what the foundation is doing. It's saying we're going to put our money where our mouth is. We're going to commit $100,000. We're going to make a long-term commitment, 10 years, long-term, sustainable, scalable program. We do see this impacting. So what we've done is to create a framework and an infrastructure. I'd like to think that other private sector leaders, other public sector leaders will look at this program and the impact of this program, and they will hold us accountable over the next 10 years. You know why? Because we've said we want to grow 10,000 entrepreneurs. We want to contribute at least 1 million new jobs to it across Africa, right? We want to contribute at least $10 billion to the African economy. We have to be held accountable to those goals that we've set ourselves. We believe fundamentally that the solution to Africa's challenges, and I don't see them as problems, because challenges are also opportunity lies with the entrepreneurs and with African entrepreneurs.
But what approach best suits private sector intervention?
Exactly what we're taking, right? Which is to find those from 0 to 3 year old businesses, create an enabling environment for them where we can provide them skills development training. An entrepreneur doesn't fall from the sky, you grow an entrepreneur. How do you become an entrepreneur? By making mistakes, implementing what you've learned from it, and going on to the next stage and the next stage. I know I've done that for the last 30 years.
Exactly, I was going to ask you what your experience has been like, because you've worked very closely with entrepreneurs, you've seen them start from ground zero to where they are. Could you just tell us your experience with some entrepreneurs across Africa?
You know, I mean, I can talk about entrepreneurship in the third person, but I can talk about it from my own experience. I made over 50 films, from a very short, a 10-minute movie, to feature films, and I know that every single film I make is like starting again. You go from an idea and you have to see it on the screen, right? It requires management, it requires discipline, it requires organization, it requires skills, right? It requires the ability to sell your idea, i.e. to find paying customers for your ideas. In my case, it's always funders, right? I have to actually be able to convince you that you should part with your money, and I will make a program where I will tell a story that is really going to resonate with an audience, right? So similarly, also as a mentor, over the last 30 years, yes, one of the things that really attracts me in working with entrepreneurs is their passion, determination, and commitment. Yeah, if you don't have that fire in your belly, right, no amount of government money and interventions or even private sector is going to do. If you don't understand what is it that what is the customer's pain that you are the solution to? If you don't have, you have an idea, and if you haven't actually looked at the market viability or opportunity, if you haven't done any of that analysis, then it just remains an idea. And our program is structured to take the 1,000 that we have now selected, is to take them over the next 9 months from an idea to an implementable business plan, and help them, you know, and really a scalable and an investable business that, you know, of the thousand.
Yeah. Sorry to do that, but looking at the policies and looking at how implementable these policies are, it seems as if, you know, initiatives like the one you've actually just mentioned usually are not sustainable. And so at the end of the day, we're talking about elections, we're talking about probably continuity, we're talking about maybe a new government coming in, and we're looking at the private sector buying into all the policies that any of these governments will be bringing, you know, on board. And they have initiatives that have already started to encourage entrepreneurs to grow. But how sustainable these policies that the private sector has actually come up with, you know, be in terms of what, you know, the government at the time will be coming up with?
What we've come up with is a program which is very well structured. It's based on a very solid foundation. It's based on the foundation that it's long-term, sustainable and scalable, and it's Pan-Africa. Of the 20,000 that responded to our challenge, what we are learning a lot from. They have their finger on the pulse. They know what the trends are, right, in terms of where the pain point is, where the opportunities are for their business ideas. So we've listened, we've read every single application form. We've listened and we've seen certain patterns emerging. I'd like to think that the infrastructure that we've created through our program, we will throw up some ideas which could lead to some formulation of some policies, which the other private sector leaders in not just in Nigeria, but Pan-Africa might want to adopt. But certainly governments might want to listen to us. Why? Because we will be creating our policies based on evidence. And the evidence is the entrepreneurial network that we have just created, which is Pan-Africa.
Now, just before I let you go, Amanda, looking at the different business environments in Africa, is it possible that a single approach can work for Pan-Africa entrepreneurship, just like what you're mentioning now? Is there a one-size-fits-all kind of model to solving entrepreneurial challenge in Africa?
No, absolutely not. But what we have, what we can do is to create what I call the gem, and we see the ripple effects from that by having a really well-structured training program. These are things that can be repeated and scaled. By having mentoring in our program, by providing seed capital to entrepreneurs who have been through a training program, so they know how best to use that funding, right? By creating the networking and the network opportunities for intra-Africa trade. That's what we will do when we connect our 1,000 Pan-African entrepreneurs online as they do their 12-week program, but also when we bring them together in a group lab. Can you imagine 1,000 Pan-African entrepreneurs gathered in Lagos in July? Come and join us.
I'll try. Amanda, thank you so much for joining me on the program this morning and sharing your perspectives with us, looking at entrepreneurship in Africa. Amanda there is an expert in entrepreneurship and business development. She's also the director of entrepreneurship for Tony in the new entrepreneurship program. But that's it on today's show. Thank you so much for being a part of it. If you missed the program, log on to youtube.com/channelsweb/businessmorning to catch up. And please don't forget to follow us on Twitter. I'm Harriet Albini. Bye for now.